Good night. This is Dolores Cannon again with the Metaphysical Hour. Back on the air again. Ever since I got back from Australia, New Zealand, and my trip to the Caribbean, I've been trying to do just me, I guess. At least you know it's live shows. Ever since I've been back, I'll be starting some guests again pretty soon. But right now, I'm trying to play catch up anyway. But you know, I have so many books out there that I haven't even begun to talk about that I can always find something to talk about to fill the time anyway. Well, let me give out the number, the toll-free number, if anybody wants to call in. The toll-free number is 877-876-5227. 877-876-5227. Just in case anybody does want to call in. Most people say they just would rather listen to me talk. So whatever you want to do, it's okay with me. Okay. Well, one thing I want to tell some very good news is that I finished the book Convoluted Universe, Book 3, and it's at the printers now. And we expect it should be delivered by the 1st of February. It takes about 3 to 4 weeks at the printers once we get it there to get printed. And I know a lot of you out there have already placed the pre-publication orders. And I've got a huge stack of those we got to fill as soon as the book comes out. And everywhere I went, all over the world, everybody kept saying, when's that new book coming out? And we were able to get the pre-publication specials before the book is actually printed. On my website, you can still order it there for the cheaper price. And it's about $4 cheaper than it will be whenever it comes off the press. So we'll still honor those orders until it finally gets here. So if you want to check on my website, www.ozarkmountain.com. The name of my company is Ozark Mountain Publishing. Ozark Mountain, OZARKMT.com, the abbreviation for mountain. Or if you're in other countries, it's OZARKMT.com. And our toll-free number for my company is 1-800-935-0045. 1-800-935-0045. But I'm so glad to finally get the book to press. I've been working on it all year, and it's going to turn out to be the biggest book I've ever written. The whole Convoluted Universe series are big. They run over 600 pages. This one is 700 pages. And I kept trying to see how I could cut it, and I'd already taken out a lot of material, so I had to leave it like it was. And I've got a huge stack of material now. That means there'll be another book, probably two or three, because I'm still getting lots of information from the people that come to me, press clients. So I know I'm nowhere near finished writing, because I keep getting more and more information. But at least Convoluted 3 is at the printers and should be out in a few weeks. I want it out before I go to the UFO conference in Laughlin. That is the last week of February. So I want to get it here so we can take it there and sell it there. And you will be able to get them at the bookstores, too, as soon as the distributor gets them and gets them start circulating. Okay, but I also want to tell people about my classes. I'm going to start doing those again. This is the time of the year that I stay home, because I've been traveling so much, that during the winter I try to stay home because we can get snow here, and there may be times I can't get to the airport. So I won't be traveling again until the middle of February. My first class this year is going to be in L.A., and that's going to be, I'm going out there the 11th of February. I'll be doing some private sessions. If anybody's interested in any of these things, call our toll-free number or check our website. I'll be doing private sessions, and it's that weekend. I think it's the 15th, 16th, and 17th. I have my first class in L.A. We're still trying to find the venue. The last I've heard, they were trying to have it out by LAX, but it may be in a private home, so that part isn't worked out yet. But if anybody is interested in that class, to please contact our office and we can get you into that. I like to keep the classes small so that we can have interaction and personal feedback from the students if anybody has questions. My second class, well, I go right from LA to Laughlin, where I do the UFO conference there. And then the second class I'm going to be doing is going to be in March. And that's here in Fayetteville, Arkansas, which is my own backyard. And both of those classes, people are beginning to sign up for now. I'll have more later this year, but those are the first two. So if anybody's interested in taking the class, please notify our office and you can get in on it. Now, this is the class where I teach my technique. And a lot of people who do these classes, they don't teach them. They come one day and then somebody else takes over and does the rest of the class. I don't do it that way. I'm there the whole 3 days and I'm the only teacher you've got. So I teach you everything that I do step by step on my technique and how I'm able to get the results that I can. I've spent 30 years perfecting this technique to get it to the point it is now, so that we can have direct access to the subconscious mind and we can have instantaneous healings with the clients. So this is a very valuable form of therapy to learn. And like I said, it's taken me 30 years to finally get it to the point where I can teach it. And people all over the world are taking the class and are telling me it works for them as well as it does for me. So anybody is interested in that, please contact our office and we'll give you the information. But the next conference is the UFO conference in Laughlin. I'll be speaking there, and I'm also going to be doing a limited number of private sessions at the UFO conference in Laughlin. If anybody's there and wants a session, also contact our office. I'll be there the whole week. So I will be seeing people, but I can only do a limited number. So all of these things, if you want more information, contact either through the website or our 800 number. Or if you want to write me, email me direct. I do read all the emails when I'm here. And our email is decannon. DECANNON at MSN.com. And I try to answer as many as I can, but I get sometimes 400 emails a day, so it's difficult. But I do read them, and we try to do the best we can. Okay, and if you want to find out about my other lectures and conferences I'll be doing, you can also check on my website and click on where it says schedules, and you'll have all the places in the United States so far that I'm signed up to speak. And we're also beginning to plan the overseas trips. Looks like I'm definitely going to be going to China, Singapore, Hong Kong, Taiwan for sure, because that's where my Chinese publisher is, and not sure yet about Malaysia, but we're thinking even of going into Shanghai or some of those cities over on the mainland of China. That's all still being worked out, but I'm definitely going there. On the way, I'm going to try to do a class in Maui in Hawaii to break the trip up. And they want me to come back to Australia and do another class there in Perth. So this whole year of 2008 is already filling up. So it's like some people keep saying I need to be cloned so I can keep up with all of this. But I enjoy it because I am doing what I love, the lecturing and the writing of the books and doing the classes. All right, I think that's most of the information dealing with all of that. So tonight I was trying to think what to talk about because I don't have a guest. tonight. So there's always something I can talk about. I tell my kids, I don't know if I can find something to talk about when I don't have a guest. They said, don't worry about it. You can always find something to talk about. Because I've got so much material, and I've got many of my books that I've never even brought up yet. So there's always different subjects. So I was trying to think of what to talk about tonight, and I think I've got it all figured out. We'll see where it goes anyway. Okay. Some of this information is in the new book, but a lot of it is in the other books. But it keeps growing. It keeps expanding. Every time I get one piece of information, I get more to go with it. So it just keeps growing and adding to where it's hard to tell when one book stops and the other one begins. Even when I'm lecturing, I'm combining material from many different books because there's just so much material. Okay, but I'm going to talk tonight about the different forms that you can incarnate in. I know a lot of people have trouble with the idea of reincarnation. I guess most of the ones listening to the show don't have trouble with it because you already understand it. But the average person out there, they don't understand it. They say, what do you mean? I've lived before. This isn't my first time. I always think, they really think this is the best that God can do, this one body? And then we have to work to accomplish everything in one lifetime. It's absolutely impossible. But that is the way they've been led to believe. No, you have to come back again and again and again until you get it right. And this is a school that we go to. Earth is a school. And you do volunteer to come here. You make a contract to come here to go to school. But it's the kind of a school that you can repeat a grade, but you can't skip a grade. So if you don't get the lesson right in this lifetime, you're going to have to come back and do it again in the next lifetime. And a lot of times with the same people that you've already been dealing with. And some of my clients will say, well, I don't want to do that. I want to get rid of them. I want to get out of there. Well, then you better work it out with them now, or you're going to have to come back and do it again with the same people. Because it is just a school, and all we are doing is learning lessons. That's what it's all about. And this is a school, the information comes from my clients and from the higher self. They say Earth is a challenging planet. It's very difficult to come here, very difficult to go to school here. There's other planets that are not like this at all, but they say we come to Earth to learn emotions and limitations. And other planets, they don't have emotions. But people that are in ET bodies only have certain emotions, or they don't have any at all. See, everything is different. And when you come to Earth, it's to learn emotions and limitations, and it's very challenging. And they really are totally unexpected for this when they get here, because this is not what they thought it was going to be. It's very, very difficult. So this is your lesson right now. One other thing to make it harder is when we come into this life, we forget everything. We come in, the blinders are on. I've had people going through the birth experience, and they've been on the other side of the spirit side, and they're making their contracts with the people that they know they have karma to be paid back with, and they'll say, well, let's go back and do it again. We didn't do such a good job, did we? Let's go back and do it again. This time you be the husband, I'll be the wife, you be the mother, I'll be the daughter. You can switch the roles around any way you want to. And you make a contract with those people that let's try to get some of this worked out. Some of the problems you're having with people can go back many, many lifetimes. They get in a pattern, a rut, to where they've been repeating the same thing over and over again, trying to work it out. And it's just not working because they're too ingrained in it. And they come in hoping this time we're going to get it done and get it settled so we can move on to the next lesson. Because even during the life, you have that same thing repeated again and again. You keep drawing the same kind of people to you. You keep having the same situation come up again and again in your life. If that happens, that means you haven't learned the lesson. You haven't figured it out what it is you're supposed to be doing. So you have to keep taking it again and again until you learn. Well, I asked them one time, wouldn't it be easier if we knew why we came in? If we knew our relationship with other people, if we knew why we were here, wouldn't that make it easier? They said, no, it wouldn't be a test if you knew the answers. So we have people in my clients, and it's in my books, that they're coming in. They have their contract. They've got their nice, neat little plan all wrapped up like a little Christmas present. Okay, this is what I'm going to do. I'm going to do it right this time. I'm going to get it all accomplished. Then I won't have to come back anymore. That's the plan. The problem is, this is a planet of free will. And when you get here, everybody else is coming in with their nice little plan. And because it's a planet of free will, it all clashes because it could go in many different ways. So I've had people coming through the birth experience, and on the other side, they've made their plan, they say, I know what I want to do, and they're coming, they're being born into this lifetime, and they're saying, I gotta remember. And then they're born, and they'll say, I don't remember anymore. It's really funny, because then the blinders come down, the veil comes down, and it's starting out with a clean slate, not knowing why they're here or what they're supposed to do, fumbling around in the dark. They said it's just a play, it's just a game. Well, it's a kind of a play where you write the script, you are the actors, you're the director, but you don't have any idea what the script is all about. You write it as you go along. So it's very complicated, and I know sometimes they think it's funny the way we fumble around with this because we don't remember when we come back in. Now, you know, we are connected with the source. We call it God. They call it the source. This is where everybody comes from. And they said, one thing that's very unique about Earth is that all the other beings on the other planets, they know their connection to Source. They know where they come from, and they're very connected with it. They're very close to it, and this makes it a lot easier. But they said they admire people that come to Earth because we come in with it all taken away, all memory of it. When we're on the other side, in the spirit form, we are very aware of where we came from. We're very aware of the source and our connections to it. When we come in, it's all taken away, all forgotten, so we can start out with a clean slate. They said they admire us for that because we're the only species that is made to forget. And they said you come into this life thinking you are all alone. Thinking there's nobody there, you're all alone, which is not true. You're never alone. You always have people with you. But they say you come in forgetting everything, think you're all alone, and you have to find your way back all by yourself through all of the stuff that's out there, all of the church teachings and all of that. All the different things that we have to go through and sort out. What do I want to believe and what do I not want to believe? You have to find your way back to the source all by yourself. So they said they admire that because look at the courage that takes to think they're all alone and have to find their way back. Now, you're never alone because when you come into a life, you have a guardian angel, or a guide, whatever you want to call it, is assigned to you. And they are with you your entire lifetime. That's their job. They have to be with you to guide you and help you and protect you your entire life. Now, you may have more than one. If your life is complicated, you may have as many as four. But you always have one main one that stays with you your entire lifetime. They're always there to help you. If your life is like mine and it suddenly goes in a different direction, sometimes some of the guides will trade places. And one comes in who has more expertise in the way you're going, what you're going to be going into. So they can trade places and move around. But you always have at least one main guide that's with you your entire lifetime. And you can get in touch with this. You can do it through meditation. You can do it through dreaming. But all you have to do is believe they are there. And they're there to help you. But they cannot interfere. This is one of the main rules. But if you acknowledge they're there and ask for their help, they are more than happy to help you. Because they said, they're not allowed to interfere. They said, but if you don't ask for assistance, we have nobody to assist. They can't force their way on you. But if you ask them for anything that you really want, at first you got to know what you want. That's important too. But first you have to know what you want, but you ask them for whatever it is that you want in your life, and they are more than happy to help you attain it. I say you give them the ball, and boy, do they run with it. I've seen it happen in my life over and over again. I'll say, okay, guys, here it is. This is your next project. You handle it. You do it. And they do. They take it, and they run with it, and miracles will happen. Things that you would never, ever believe would happen once you turn it over to them. And I think it's very important to know you're not alone, because some people are afraid of dying because they think they're going to be alone. Well, you always have someone who meets you when you cross over. I call this the greeter. It could be a family member. It can be a friend that's already deceased. But if you don't have anyone like that, your guide will be there. So you are never alone. And they emphasize this over and over in my sessions. They'll say, why do you think you're alone? We're always with you. They'll always be there to take care of you. And I think that's very important for people to understand. Anyway, let me go back to the beginning when we were all created. And I'm going to see how much I can get in this time about that part. Now, in the beginning was God, or the source. I may refer to it back and forth because when we're doing the sessions, everybody calls it the source. Even the ETs call it the source. They are extremely close to the source. They're closer to God than we will ever be. They understand it more than we will. But people think, even if they accept the idea of reincarnation, they think it's always been in a human body. This is all they know. Well, it's not true. This is just one of the roles you can play, one of the parts you can play in this game, in this stage play, in this school. It's just one of the parts to be in a human body. This, you have a body. You are not a body. You have a body. This is a suit of clothes you're wearing at this time to play this part. I like to call it, people call it a vehicle. I like to call it a suit of clothes or a costume. It's one you have put on to play this part. But like all suits of clothes, eventually it's going to wear out and have to be thrown away. Doesn't matter how much you like it, how much you like to wear it. how attached you are to that suit of clothes, eventually it'll wear out and you'll have to throw it away. Then you just go and get another suit of clothes, another costume to play the next role that you're going to be called on to play, or that you agree to do. You say, okay, let's try this now and see what that's going to be like. Because it's just adventures and lessons and experiences. What did I learn from that? Then you go on to the next one. Well, in the beginning, we were all with God, with the Source. I've had people come to me, and I always have them come with a list of questions, and they'll say, well, the list of questions sometimes will be, where do I come from? And I said, well, we've all come from the same place. And some of them will say, well, what's my home planet? You don't have a home planet. You may be a different planet you live on in your lives, different schools you go to, but you don't come from a certain planet. We all come from the Source. That's where everybody began. When they say, where do I come from? I say, we all came from the same place. We were all with God in the very beginning. And it was a tremendous, wonderful feeling. I've had people experience it when they go back there during the sessions. There is such love that you can't even describe it. It's a tremendous feeling of love and compassion, and they don't want to leave. It's all together, and they don't want to leave. It is overwhelming, the feeling they have when they're there. Well, in the beginning, God was content with all of us there. We were all part of God. That's why they say, we are God. We can do anything you want to do because you have powers beyond belief, because we're all one with God. Well, God wanted to learn. And one way he decided to do it was to send his children, I guess you would call us, out to learn and bring information back to him. He couldn't learn on his own. So what he did, he exploded out. This is what is called the Big Bang Theory. He exploded out into all these millions and millions of little tiny particles. They all went shooting out in all directions. These little sparks. This is called the Big Bang Theory, and it continues now because all these sparks are still moving out, and the scientists have proved the universe is in motion and is moving. Some of these little sparks became galaxies. Some of them became planets. And many of them became our own individual souls. So when you take you back to what you really are in the very beginning, all you are is a tiny, tiny spark, a tiny little piece of light. That is all you are, is this tiny little piece of light, this tiny little spark. Then we see ourselves in these other images because that happens along the way. But the real you, the soul, is nothing but this tiny spark. We were sent out, and God said, go and learn. Learn absolutely everything, everything you can find, and then bring it back to me. So we were sent out to have many, many lifetimes of everything you can possibly imagine, to have all of these adventures, to gather information, all types of information, to gather as much as we could possibly gather in. And then we're supposed to, at the very end, take it all back to God. Now, this happens with many, many lifetimes, going back and forth to the spirit side, getting new assignments, and being sent out again and again. It takes eons, because we have to learn absolutely everything. And then we return to God with all of the information we have gained during all of these hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of lifetimes. In this way, we are like cells in the body of God, accumulating information and sending it back, just the way the cells in the body do. So we are cells in the body of God gathering information and sending it back. Because that's what people say. What is the ultimate? The ultimate is goal is to return to God and not have to go out again, to stay there. So when we go out, we have to be everything. Now, Earth is a young planet. It's only been over here in this part of the galaxy for just a short time, really, this part of the cosmos. It's a young planet. And we are deliberately isolated over here because they don't want us to contaminate the rest of the universe. The ETs are afraid of us, believe me. We're the ones that are violent. And they don't want us contaminating everybody else. So we're isolated over here in this part of the universe, the part of the cosmos. So we are a young planet. So you can't expect us to have all the information. This is not your first life. So you have had lives on other planets, other dimensions, many of them as an energy being where you are nothing but light. You have had all these different lifetimes before you came to Earth. And after you complete all of the lessons of Earth, then you'll go back to somewhere else. Maybe you'll go on to other planets, other realms, other dimensions. Try other adventures, other things. So there's more and more and more to learn all the time. But let me concentrate on Earth for the purpose of this talk. Not on all the other adventures you've had before you come here. So when you come to Earth, you have to be everything. That means absolutely everything, not just human. Human is only one of the adventures that you have to have. So when you come here, you have to try on all of these different things. I'm going to say this in linear fashion, because that's the way our minds work. They say it doesn't really work that way, that it's not, you know, one event after the other, that it's really all happening simultaneously. It's all happening at the same time. But there again, that's a little hard for our minds to take, to understand at this point. I'll get into some of these concepts later when I get into the information that's in the convoluted universe series. But for the point of this talk, let's keep it in a linear fashion where one event follows the other in succession. Be a little easier to get my point across and to understand. I can appreciate the beings that talk through my clients. They keep saying it's so difficult to put this in words that you can understand because we don't have the concepts. They said it is not your minds, it's not your brains, it's your mind. The mind has no concept that you can base some of these things on. So they said we will never know or have all the information. They said some information is as poison rather than medicine. So we will never be allowed all of the answers. It's too complicated. But I'll go step by step anyway. One of the first forms of life you have to be is gas, the air. That type of it's I don't know what you want to call it, a chemical. But see, I've been told absolutely everything is alive. And in the beginning, I had a hard time with this because I thought it meant with only human bodies. But in the book, The Legacy from the Stars, and that's one that is now out of print, I had the story of this man. He came to me and he said he wanted to go back to the first life he had ever lived on Earth. And in those days, I thought, well, okay, he's going to go back to the life as a caveman or something like that, very primitive. So I was very surprised when he went back to a lifetime when the Earth had not cooled down enough yet to support life. There were still active volcanoes. The earth was still rumbling. There was lots of lava, and there's all these chemicals being poured into the air, especially ammonia, that the atmosphere, everything was too toxic to support life at that point, that it had to be changed before life could begin to form. The primeval soup had to be just right before life would form. So the what he went to lifetime, he was part of the air. And his job, along with many others, was to clean these chemicals out of the air, to filter the air. His job was to clean the ammonia and those kind of fumes from the air to balance the atmosphere out. And here it's, you're thinking, here he is like, I don't know what you would call him, a chemical. He's part of the atmosphere, but yet he still had an intelligence that he could communicate with me as we did this. So he went through the whole thing. This must have taken eons of time to clean the air, to get it to the point where it would begin to be able to support life. And when he wasn't working with these others, filtering the air, he would go into the lava and fly around in the lava, enjoy that. So he was very much alive and very much doing his job. And in that lifetime, he stayed there until the planet cooled down, the chemicals were right, and they began to have the first forms of life form. And the first forms of life formed in the sea. And he experienced all these different bodies before he got to the point that he could go on, for he was finally first animal and then like an animal human type in the very beginning of forms of Earth. But this was a big surprise to me to think of somebody could have a life like that. Now, since then, I have had other people do the same thing. But that was the first case that I ever had like that. So the first experiences you have to have is being part of the air. Now remember, every life has a lesson. There's something you have to learn as you go through these different lifetimes. This is one that is important. Some of these lifetimes may not last that long. You learned your lesson quicker. Well, from there, you have to know what it's like to be a rock, the dirt. What is it like to be a rock? Everything is alive. It's only vibrating at a different frequency. So when you're a rock, you are still alive. You know what's going on. I've had people do sessions where they were a rock. And they said it was very slow. The vibration was very slow. The life was very slow. But it was like you have to learn what it's all about. What is it like? Then you have to know what is it like to be a plant. But when we do this, we finally begin to get the idea. Everything is alive. We would treat nature much better if we realized we had been these things. We had experienced these things. So when you're a plant, what is that like? I've had people be an ear of corn, enjoy just growing there and the breeze, not realizing that a cow may come along and eat them, but they said it's a very pleasant life. I've had people be a flower, and they said it's very beautiful and wonderful. The only thing is a flower doesn't live very long. So they had to experience what it was like to be all of these different plants, and my curiosity and the questions I like to ask, I want to know, what is this like? What does it feel like? So then you have to learn to be what it's like to be an animal. What is it like to be a wolf and be able to run? What would it be like to be a bird and be able to fly? I have had people, many, many of them, go through different lifetimes where they were different animals. In the new book, Convoluted 3, I have a whole section on people who have gone through lifetimes as animals. And when I do my sessions, with my curiosity, I want to ask all the questions I could possibly think of. I want to know, what is it really like to be that animal? What is it like to experience that? I had one person who very unexpectedly went into the life where she was a little yellow worm. And at first she didn't know what it was, because she had been chewing away at a leaf on a tree when the leaf suddenly fell off and with her on it, and she landed in a stream at the bottom of the tree. She was floating down the stream, and she said, "What am I going to do? What am I going to do? I don't have any hands. All I have are these little stubby feet, and I can't get off of this leaf." So she was really experiencing the lifetime as a little yellow worm. I've had one thing I think was very fascinating when I had people be birds. One person was an eagle, and she said all of the energy of the eagle was concentrated into the eyes. And she was sitting on a cliff where her nest was, looking out across the valley. And she said, "The colors are so intense, and the shadows are so dark. It is this different way of seeing than a human sees." And as she looked at the valley below, when she saw a motion, like if she saw a rabbit running across the valley, all of a sudden, the entire field of vision would change to where it looked like infrared, where she was picking up the energy of the animal and the motion. And if she was hungry, then she would dive down and get the rabbit. But this time she wasn't, so she was just watching it. But when she would see motion, the entire field of vision would change from this intense color shadow contrast to this bright, this red, like infrared vision. And at night, she said, the same thing would occur when you would see motion. But at night when she saw motion, the field of vision was a greenish color. And she was able to pick up the energy of anything that was moving. And I said, that really sounds like these night vision goggles that the soldiers wear when they pick up this greenish cast to people. Or when you see the movies where the robots and the all that, they're able to see this bluish green field of vision. I wonder where it comes, they got the idea from. This is exactly the way the eagle sees. And I think it must be all night birds, like the owl, must see the same way. I think that was fascinating, because how do the scientists really know how birds see? You can cut the bird apart, but can you really know what's going on in the mind of that bird? To me, that's the most fascinating part. So this was how the bird was able to see. Now, I've had people be spiders. Now, spiders, you know, have many eyes. And I often wondered about that. How do the spiders see? They said it's like looking through many different TV sets. Like if you go into a store and you see all of these TV sets all on display, and the same picture is on each TV set. That's the way they see it. But they say we don't look through all of those eyes at the same time. It would be too confusing, too much information. We focus on the eye where there is motion and movement. That's the eye they focus on, and not on the others. And I had someone be a fly. It was the same way, because, you know, a fly has a faceted eye. And they said the same thing. They would focus on the segment or facet where there was motion, and the rest was ignored. So I want information, and that's why I want to know how all of these things see and how they operate. A cat, I found, they said a dog senses things more by smell, but a cat is different. They said a cat, when he first looks at a person, he doesn't see a person. He sees an energy field. First, he sees an energy field. Then he sees it form into a person. And but it's not a person at first. It's just an energy. And I could identify with that because I always did think animals could see things that we don't see. But I didn't know how exact until I got that example. Because when my husband was in Vietnam, this is many years ago, it was back in the 50s and 60s, he was in Vietnam, and I was living in St. Louis, right across from Tower Grove Park. They have all of these old brownstone houses, two-story houses that are all alike, one after the other. I was living there with my kids while he was in Vietnam. We soon found out that our house was haunted. I didn't have any choice. I couldn't move. I had to stay there until he got back. But we knew it was haunted, especially the ghost seemed to be upstairs because we could have doors. My kids used to sleep upstairs, and I slept downstairs. But we'd have doors opening, closing. Lights would go on and off. At night, you'd hear steps running up and down the steps, footsteps. We just nicknamed him George, and we just thought it was funny, and we just learned to live with it. But at night, sometimes I'd be sitting in the living room trying to watch TV, and our Siamese cat, Boots, would be sitting at the foot of the steps, staring up at the landing at the top of the steps, where I couldn't see it. And he'd sit there staring. And you know how they do when they're watching something? Their ears are very alert, and their tail is flicking back and forth and back and forth. He would sit there doing that. You know, he was watching something. And finally, I'd get so upset with him. I said, Boots, will you please go and catch a mouse and stop that? Apparently, he was seeing the energy of our friendly ghost, but he couldn't figure out what it was. Because it wasn't a person that he could identify with. So these are some of the things I've found out with animals, and I think it's fascinating. But then there's also another form of life that we can be is the guardians of the animals. Every culture in the world has the legends of this, the nature spirits. The Indians have them. They're very close to nature. They know all about the fairies, the dwarfs, the goblins, the elves. All of these things are the guardians of nature, the guardians of the plants and the animals. They take care of them. That's their job. And they are very active in doing this. It's a very important job. But we have also experienced lifetimes as these little people. When I'm in England, they can identify with this a lot. People used to be, they could see the fairies. They knew they were there. They knew the little people, the little dwarves and gnomes and elves were there because they lived in agriculture environments. But now that we have moved into more technological environments, it's harder to see them. I said, unless you think about the gremlins that like to act up in my computer, play games with my computers and my tape recorders. Otherwise, we're not really aware of these little beings. But we have all lived lives as these little beings. Next, you come to the humans. And this is all part of the evolution of the soul as it moves into these different parts. Now, I have found that the animal kingdom is different than the human soul. The animal kingdom has a group soul, and you can readily identify with this when you think of hives of bees, colonies of ants, flocks of birds, herds of cattle. You know, they all seem to move as a unit. They are individuals, but they seem to have a group mentality. So when you That is what they are. Now, in order to evolve into the human, they have to be given a personality and an individuality and to be pulled away from the group soul. This can be done with love. Everything is love anyway. Everything goes back to love. That's what it's all about. That's what we're trying to learn is love. If you take an animal and take it into your home, give it a personality, give it an individuality, show it love, you are pulling it away from the group soul. Then it is ready to evolve into a human because you have given it a personality. So then we're ready to go into the human forms. Okay. Now you get into the human, you have to be everything. Here again, there's no way any could possibly do all of these things in one lifetime. But you get to be to the human. You have to be male and female many, many times. And this aggravates a lot of men whenever I tell them this at a lecture. They'll say, what do you mean? I've always been a man. I've never been a woman. What do you mean? But what would you learn by being one sex continually down through time? You wouldn't learn very much. You have to learn what it's like to be both. So sooner or later, you have to be the opposite sex. And this, I think, is a very good explanation for some homosexuals. They have been the one sex so many times in other lifetimes. Now they have to change and be the opposite sex. They don't know how to. It's unfamiliar to them. They don't understand it. So they have problems with it. I've heard many people say, I feel like a woman trapped in a man's body. And many people try sex operations, sex change operations. That's not going to work because you have to come back sooner or later as that other sex to learn how it functions, how it adapts, what is it like. You have to learn what it's like to be everything. So you have to be male and female many, many times. Then you have to be rich and poor. You have to live on every continent in the world. You have to be every race in the world. You have to be every religion in the world. Have to know what it is like to be on every side of every coin in every situation before you're finished. That's a lot. That's why it can't be done in one lifetime. You can do part of it, but you can't do it all. If more people would understand this and understand the rules of reincarnation, we wouldn't have the violence. We wouldn't have the wars and the fighting because it takes away prejudice and judging. How can you judge someone when you have done all of this yourself? And if you do, if you are prejudiced against anyone, and if you are judging them, you will have to come back as the very thing that you are judging and experience what that is like. This is the way the law of karma works. You don't get out of it. So if you understood these rules, it would do away with judging and prejudice because you realize you've either been these other races, religions, or you're going to be if you come on too strong against it. See how clear it is, how much it makes sense. But anyway, when you're all finished with all of the things that you can learn, then in between you're going back and forth to the spirit side, getting your assignments, then it's time to return to source, to return to God with all of your information you've accumulated over thousands and thousands of lifetimes and to download it into the gigantic computer that is God. And, but when I'm telling this at a lecture, sometimes people get very depressed looks on their face. You mean I got to do all of that? And I said, well, I'd like to think that by the time you have reached this point where you want to learn, you want to know, you want to ask questions, you're into the metaphysical way of thinking. And I think by that time you have probably gone through most of this. You probably learned most of the lessons you have to learn, otherwise you wouldn't be questioning. You wouldn't, and I think you're getting close to the end to where it's time to return to God, or return to the source. And that's what the ultimate is supposed to be. We want to go back to where we came from, where we started out. And we're home again. That's home, is back to the source. Then I've had some people in the lecture say, then what? Well, that's supposed to be the ultimate. That's supposed to be the final goal. And it looks like we're coming up to the clock again. Now, I think you can tell when I'm doing this, I go into lecture mode because these are a lot of things I lecture about anyway. But maybe this will give you something to think about. But the part in the new book is dealing with the animal lives and the lives as rocks and plants and all the different things you can experience. Because not only human life, you also experience every type of alien life you could think of, every type of dimension, energy, lifetime. There's more than you can possibly ever imagine that you have to experience before you're finished and you go back home again to be with God. All right, so we're coming down to the wire now. Remember, if you want to check my website, it's ozarkmountain.com, ozarkmt.com, or ozarkmt.com, or call my toll-free number, 1-800-935-0045. Okay, I guess it's time to call it to a night again. So thanks, everybody, for listening. And good night.
If you enjoyed the show, check out more of our other videos and be sure to subscribe and click the like button. Thank you for listening to the Metaphysical Hour with Dolores Cannon.